Hi everyone, welcome to another installment of Dublin Tech Talks. As always, we're brought to you with the support of Icon Accounting. Icon are a provider of full range of services for professional contractors. So if you are a contractor or thinking about contracting, you can reach out to them for all sorts of support and advice. Today I'm speaking to Emily Brick. Emily is the founder and chief analyst for a company called Athena Analytics. Athena is the analytics partner for post-primary schools in Ireland. So they work with schools to make sure that students reach their full academic potential. And I think we all know that, unfortunately, the school systems can be a very, very busy place. So their mission really is to make sure that, no student gets left behind. Emily, thanks for joining me today. Lovely to speak to you and really keen to hear the background on your story and how this business came about. But do you want to just start by maybe telling us a little bit about your own background?
Yeah, of course. So I studied financial maths and actuarial science in UCC. And then
fun
I went on
there,
to...
Yeah.
What?
Fun stuff.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. So then I went on to do a master's in statistics. And following that, then I worked in various roles in statistics, basically. So I worked in Betfair. And then I went... Well, I was in a data science type role there. And then I went from there to Musgrave, so quite a change, but again, in a data science type role, which is one of the great things about data science. You know, you can end up in any industry, you know, it's very interesting. So that they were both in Dublin. And then after that, I went to Melbourne for a year and worked in the Department of Education. And then I moved back to Kerry, where I'm from, in 2017, and I set up Athena Analytics, and that's what I've been doing since.
And you've mentioned there that the application of data science can be really interesting depending on what your focus is. Do you think having a kind of a broad early exposure to different industries did that help just in terms of your view of what data science can do for a business?
Oh, definitely. Especially going from Betfair, where everything and all the data you have coming in is online, so it's all very clean and very easy to use, to go into Musgrave, where a lot of the data coming in was also offline. Mm-hmm. Even those two big differences, where gives you a lot of insight into the different ways that data can be used and can come to you. Definitely early exposure to different industries, I think, was helpful, yeah.
Good. And then, so back to the homeland and... What was the idea for Athena? How did you come up with a problem that you thought needed to be solved? And clearly your exposure to the education sector in Australia, did that kind of give you a genuine, interest and view of that industry?
Yeah, well, just before I went to Australia, I did a small bit of consulting and I helped a school reviewing their Leaving Cert exams. Mm-hmm. So I was really surprised at kind of the setup in the schools in Ireland that they didn't have more analytics tools. And then I went to the Department of Education in Australia and I saw everything they had there. But when I came back initially, I was just kind of setting up a consulting business. You know, I didn't have a huge problem I was going to solve, but I did think there was a gap in schools, but I didn't really know exactly what they were looking for or what the problem to solve was, but I started doing those really simple reports and I promoted them to schools and schools were interested in that. And I did that for them for about a year. So through doing those reports, I was in and out of schools, and what they really were looking for was a way to track students on an ongoing basis that was individual to each student and their own potential. And so that's what the idea grew out of. And that's when the business became very targeted in building that exact software. Mm. So it was kind of then that the idea really came, after maybe a year and a half into the business.
Great. And I think that, kind of times like we've had recently, with a crisis, whether it's financial or a health crisis, I mean, it can often be the catalyst for people to, to move forward an idea. Like, some people are naturally entrepreneurial. Some people are unfortunately, forced entrepreneurs. I think what we've been talking about in different sessions over the last while is the support that's available to help people who have an idea, make it a reality. So how did you go about turning that idea into a business, and what supports did you avail of?
Yeah, I suppose at the very start, I was lucky in that I started off doing some consulting and doing, you know, I had early schools customers. So it was probably really when, again, when I was about a year and a half in, when I started to look at things I could do. And one program that I did was the Acorns program. It's for women. Yeah. So it's for women who've set up a business in rural Ireland. It's a round table monthly meetup. And we're about 10 entrepreneurs meet up and discuss their most recent challenge and how to get over that. And I found for me, that's really where I went from the business just being myself working on it to growing it. And in the course of that, some of the advice I got was to talk to the local enterprise office. And at that point, I had had the idea for the tracker and I had various things done about it. But I suppose it's taking that leap into actually doing it. And when I went to the local enterprise office, they went through all the different grants and all that for me. And I ended up eventually getting the business expansion grant out of it. And that led me to start building the tracker and made a big difference.
Great.
But like even beyond the local enterprise office, who've been brilliant, like locally here, you know, I got advice from my now accountant, James Kelleher from Casey Stevenson really early. Like, you know, I went to him and said, like, this is my business idea. What do you think? And he just talked me through how you start a business, which was really good early on, you know.
Yeah, I think, you know, between the Acorn program and your account, I think just having that external advice and support and not being afraid to reach out to people and get some help and advice, and that is really key. So to get back to Athena, so what about the platform and the technology? So, you know, you've mentioned that it's, you know, perhaps different from other tools in that it's focused on individuals. So we're not just looking at school performance, right? It comes right down to unlocking the potential of each individual. So how does the platform work? What's it based on? And why is it different from other tools that maybe, you know, look to this same issue?
Yeah, so I suppose the way it might be similar to another tool, is that you see all of the exam results of a student on the software. But what's different is, as you said, is it's calculating the student's potential constantly. So from the user's perspective, we'll say when a student comes in and they do aptitude tests on arrival in school, we look at those aptitude tests. We compare them with all of the other aptitude tests we have in the system. So we've over 70,000 students on it now. And we say, okay, show us what students with similar aptitude tests went on to get in each exam. So that's how we base our initial potential for each student.
Yeah.
And then beyond that, as students do exams throughout school, we update their potential. And the whole goal of it is to identify when a student falls below that potential and to highlight that to teachers and management in schools.
So potential is quite a subjective word, right? And I mean, I've never really thought about it, but does your tool track the changes in potential? Because some people will flourish and grow in you know, what they can achieve, and others may, you know, plateau, you know, to a degree. I'm not an educational psychologist. Is that true? Is there variance in potential? Is it a movable feast as kids and young adults move through the systems?
Absolutely. Like, I mean, I suppose from our perspective, like initially when we built the software, and what other similar things out there do is they take a student's initial aptitude test and then that's their potential, whereas ours constantly updates based on a student's exam results. And like that gap in terms of what a student's potential is when they come in versus when they're leaving school is something we have looked at with schools. It's really interesting, like how that gap has been bridged. You know, often like the story would be like that student just worked ferociously hard while they were in school and that kind of thing. And that's where we've seen it bridged. But I suppose from our perspective, you know, we're all about trying to predict the potential based on the past exam results. Now we can't take everything into account. You know, you can't take into account the support system a student has or how hard they work. But from our perspective, I suppose, you know, it is objective. You know, we are saying this is the calculation and we can track it for schools, you know, how the student has done overall versus their own potential.
I guess it's trying to give teachers a holistic view, right, of the individual. And as you say, that intervention may only be able to go so far, but at least there's someone reaching out and it's not just, you know, overlooked in, you know, as per your website, and as we said earlier, what can be a really busy school system. It's nobody's fault, but there's just so much going on that it can be easy to overlook, you know, one individual. So I guess, like, in from your experience in the real world with the product being in, like, in any examples or insights in kind of, you know, a real world example of how this has had an impact on an individual or a school or administrative staff?
Yeah, like, and I suppose the main benefit goes to just what you said, like, about schools being so busy. Like, I suppose, you know, students do exams as they go through school, and it's not realistic for a school to be able to figure out after each exam, okay, who are the students who need our attention? You know, like, you know, a school might have 1,000 students. So to figure out who it is and then to have the time to meet all those students. Like, so what ours does is it, you know, narrows down the list of students that need intervention and help from the school. Mm. And, like, it means that, you know, like, previous to our software, you know, schools were spending all this time crunching the numbers and trying to figure out what they meant. Whereas now we've taken all that work out, and all of that time now can be spent with teachers reviewing students and talking to them about their results and their potential and where they are against it. And, like, I suppose also what it means is that if a parent rings in or a student wants to talk about their results, that really quickly management or a teacher or whoever is talking to them can say, okay, this is exactly where you're at versus your potential, you know, at a click of a button, you know, they have all that information to them. So it really just takes out that workload in crunching the numbers for them, you know, and giving them their insights immediately, you know.
And does it kind of, in your experience, has it, you know, the ability to focus the learner as well? So because they're not talking about a result, it's your potential. So it is quite personal and intrinsic. So do you find that the kids buy into this and kind of, you know, do have something really personal to them to achieve for, rather than just an arbitrary kind of marking or grading system?
Yeah, like, absolutely. Like, you know, and that's what been one of the biggest, the nicest feedbacks we've heard in terms of, like, that, you know, teachers have shown this to students and said, look, this is your potential, you're below it, you know, this is your own individual potential. And like, yeah, it's very motivating for students, not only to see what their calculated potential is, but also to have someone from the school saying, you know, you can reach this, and, you know, we can work together on you reaching this. So yeah, and it puts it there in black and white in front of them, rather than a conversation where the teacher's just saying, I think you could do better, you know?
Yeah. Great. And then just, you know, I mean, you've been running the product and the business for a few years now. Have you learned anything about the platform or what the insights can do as you've, you know, gone through that journey, or, you know, has anything surprised you?
I mean, a lot of the feedback we've gotten has surprised me. I didn't realize it would uncover so many things. Like, you know, the main students that the software brings you to are those that have kind of fallen down in their potential across the board. And, you know, we've gotten feedback from schools that it has uncovered things like problems that are going on at home or, like, students having mental health issues and, like, a whole host of things I never thought would come out of the software, you know. I thought of it from a pure academic perspective, you know. So that's been a great feedback to get. But I suppose, like, in terms of practical terms, there are lots of different ways the schools are using the software, which I didn't expect them to, you know, even for, like, students picking subjects for senior cycle, or even looking at where their strengths lie and using that to say, okay, what should we do in college? And yeah, lots. And, like, I mean, I suppose the junior and leaving cert were obviously cancelled last year, and we were able to help schools come up with grades, or just to help them in that process of coming up with results. So
a few very happy kids, a few unhappy kids with that, I'd say. It was very difficult for young people who'd worked so hard for so long. It was such an unprecedented situation. So I think we did as well as we could in that. I guess the education sector has a reputation of being, you know, relatively difficult nut to crack, just because of, you know, how it's run and how it needs to be run. Have you had a positive experience in working with the schools that you partner with? Have you any learnings that you would like to share with another founder, perhaps, who's looking to, you know, take a product to the education space?
Yeah, like, I suppose my perspective, like, it's been very positive, you know, from the very start in the first product. I've had really interested schools who are very clear on what they want. Like, they mightn't have 3 hours to talk to you about it, but, you know, they're very clear on what they want. And if you can deliver that they are willing to support you. And like, that's really what has grown the product so quickly, you know, has been the willingness of schools to give feedback and get involved. Mm. And, you know, they're motivated by really getting, helping a student get the most out of themselves while they're at school, you know. So I think they're very positive relationship with schools, definitely. Mm-hmm. In terms of advice for someone looking to work with schools, like, I suppose the main thing to be conscious of is the time that you know, principals and teachers have. Like, it's so, you know, they've such little time and they're in such hectic environments. Mm. So whatever you're building or hoping to sell to them, it definitely needs to be something that takes into account, that takes that into account. Like, in building my software, a big thing was that the setup first day would be really short and really quick and really easy and not require much training. And in terms of using as well, that it'd be really, really easy to use.
Okay. So what's next in terms of, you know, your planning? Is it just to just get more customers on board? Is anything that you would like to try and do differently?
Definitely try to get more schools in Ireland and improve the software in Ireland. But we've also just gotten the software into our first UK school. So hopefully we'll build on that as well. And then, you know, at this point now, we have a mixture of skills in terms of software development and data science and expertise in education. So we will be looking at other ways to combine that skill set, you know, to see what else we could offer to schools or other educational institutions.
Great. So exciting times ahead, hopefully.
Hopefully, yeah.
So if somebody wanted to get in touch with you, you know, if anyone's watching this on a school board perhaps and is interested or just wants to find out more, they can just reach you on LinkedIn and go through the website. Is that the best way to get you?
Yeah, either of those is fine. So the website's athena.ie. Yeah.
Okay. Well, Emily, thanks for sharing all this with us. Really excited to see how you guys progress over the next few years and best of luck with everything.
Brilliant. Thanks a million, David. Thanks for having
me. Thanks. Well, thanks again to Emily for that and all the great work that Athena are doing. As always, if you want to keep on top of the content we're releasing, you can join our meetup.com group. So it's DublinTechTalks@meetup.com, or you can keep an eye on the LinkedIn page for these releases. We do hope in 2021 to be back doing physical meetups, but obviously a lot depends on how everything goes. We'll continue with the virtual meetups and the lunch and learns, and more profiling interviews like we've just done with Athena. So we will see you again soon. Bye.